Today we are going to start the third module, second topic, that is fatigue fracture and crack arrest. Before proceeding, let us see what is fatigue. It is the phenomena of failure of a material due to the application of material under the cyclic load. Okay, so cyclic load can be of fully loading or unloading fully. So cyclic means loading fully or unloading fully. Okay, for example, the real life example is given is bungee jumping, stripe and base plate. So you have seen the bungee jumping. When we jump on the bungee jumping, either we will load it fully or when we will retract back, it is unloading fully. Okay, so those kind of load is known as cyclic load. Okay, so now cyclic loading means not required to have same loading stress, strain rate as unloading. That means the loading and unloading stress, strain and strain rates are independent. It's not like how much amount of loading you are doing for cyclic, unloading also having the same value. And also it is not required to be same for all cycles of loading. Okay, so now based on that, let us proceed. We will see classification of fatigue cycling. Okay, so now it depends upon the number of cycle. Because it's a fatigue cycle, let us see what number it depends. So it depends on two conditions. First one, what is first one? First one is if number of cycle before fracture is less than 10 to the power of 4. Okay, so suppose your system failed before 10 to the power of 4 cycles only. If your system fails before 10 to the power of 4 cycles only. Understood, your system, it is going under the cyclic loading condition. So 10 to the power of 4 cycles, if it is before that only the failure happened, then that kind of loading is known as low fatigue cycle. Okay, now if your number of cycle is greater than 10 to the power of 4. Okay, so suppose your bungee jumping system only, if it fails before 10 to the power of 4 cycle, then it has failed under the low fatigue cycle. If it has sustained 10 to the power of 4 or more than that, then the failure happens, then that is known as high fatigue cycle. Okay, so now we understood that fatigue failure depends upon the number of cycles which we apply. Okay, in fatigue, the material will fail below the yield stress level and it will be difficult to predict the failure as it exhibits without prior intimation. Okay, you cannot find a sudden change in its, you cannot find the regular change in its structure which will give you the intimation that from here it is going to fail or from till this time it is going to fail. It's nothing like that. Since it is a yield stress failure, because of the yield stress it is failing, that's why there is no prediction of the failure. Without any intimation it will get failed. Okay, so that will happen in brittle fracture due to the strain hardening. Okay, so now because of that, we will go into study about the crack branching. What is crack branching? So for that, I want to show you something so that it will be more clear for you how it looks like. What is crack branching? Let us see. Okay, so you can see on the screen, this is some of the crack branching phenomenon. Okay, so from here it is clear that if the crack is propagating in this direction till here, or if the crack is propagating in this direction till here, or the crack is propagating in this direction. You can see the arrow here. If it is propagating in this direction or in this direction, or it has started propagating in this direction, we are unable to identify exactly after this point which direction it is going to propagate. We are unable to predict. Not exactly we can predict. Okay, so here you can see the different direction in which it has been propagated. See the propagation, how it has happened. So this all, instead of becoming a straight crack, it started changing into branches. Okay, so these are the few branches you can see here. This is one branch, this is two branch. In this also, the crack propagated in different directions, and see here how the branches has propagated. So instead of propagating in a straight line way, it can move in any direction. Okay, so that's what is crack branching we are going to study all about. Okay, so crack branching. Crack will propagate in the direction which is proposed or described by two different way based on two different theories. Okay, so we have just estimated based on these two theories, the crack will propagate. This is what our estimation is. Instead of this estimation also, exactly how the crack will branch out or will propagate, it is unknown. Okay, so we can estimate it by two different theories. The first theory is known as maximum principal stress theory. And the second theory is known as minimum principal strain theory. Okay, so this is maximum principal stress theory and the other one is minimum principal strain theory. When we talk about a maximum principal stress theory, the direction in which maximum principal normal stress applied, normal stress is applied, we assume in that direction only the crack will propagate. Okay, so according to this theory, the crack that has initiated were propagated along the direction where the maximum principal stress will happen. So what is the maximum principal stress will happen? It will happen in the maximum principal normal stress direction, normal principal stress direction. Okay, and the other theory says, okay, first theory is in the normal principal normal stress direction. Whatever direction we have decided to give the stress, in the same direction the crack will propagate or crack will branch. Whereas the second one is minimum principal strain theory or minimum principal density theory, we call it as. Okay, so that is nothing but according to the maximum principal strain theory, the crack propagation take place along 45 degree of the direction of maximum principal strain theory. So if it is along the 45 degree to the direction of maximum principal strain, then this will happen. Okay, so these are the two principles based on which we estimate that the crack will propagate or will crack will branch out. Fine. So now, the crack will not propagate in a single direction, and that is our problem, as it is intended. It will propagate along direction which exhibit maximum value of stress and strain at particular point instantaneously. Okay, so the phenomena of crack deviation from its original path. So what is the definition for this? Definition for this is the phenomena of crack deviation from its original path is known as crack branching. So in this diagram, you can see this is the original path of your crack. But due to the maximum value of stress and strain at particular point, the crack will started branching out. It will start moving in the other direction than the normal direction of the crack. Okay, and that is known as crack branching. Fine. So now, understood? It's very simple concept. As you have seen the branches in the tree, the root you can assume. This is simple in simple. If you want to understand, this is the root of the tree or the bark of the tree. Bark, after the bark of the tree, the branches will start propagating. Not the root of the tree, bark of the tree. Okay, and that the branches will start propagating. So we cannot assume like in which direction the branches of the tree will propagate. So in the case of the material, we are telling that wherever the maximum stress and strains are proceeding in the same direction, it may exceed. Okay, so now we know that crack length 2a. We know that from the first chapter we are studying the same thing, that the crank length, let it be assumed as a 2a, is directly proportional to the energy rate. As crack length increases, the rate of the energy G will also increase. Why? Because both are, why? Because both are directly proportional. Okay, directly proportional means if length of the crack increases, then the rate of energy also increases. Correct. Now the crack branching leads to the open new path continuously, leads to the rapid increase in G comparatively. So if there is keep on increasing the length of the crack, or the branching of the crack will keep on increasing, which will result in the increase in the G value. Okay. So that's why just now this G value is what energy it is releasing during the crack propagation, that is G. So just assume G is the energy generated or releasing the energy due to the crack opening. Whenever the crack will propagate, the crack will open, that time whatever energy is releasing or generating, that is G. So G is the energy which is deriving, which is driving the crack opening. So it is responsible, it is directly responsible for the crack opening. Whereas there is one more energy known as resistance. So resistance, which resistance of the material will offer to its loading depend upon the condition, is known as R. That means this is the resistance force against G. Okay. So in other word, I can see G is the driving force, means which is driving or which is supporting the crack opening. Whereas the resistance force is opposing that crack opening. This is the resistance of that particular material. Of that particular material. If you have steel, it will have different, whatever materials are there for that particular material, the resistance of that particular material will differ. Whereas this G will depend upon the how much stress you are giving or applying. Okay. So we can say that G and R are exactly the opposite phenomenon. Okay, one is the driving force and other one is the resisting force. Okay, so now in other words, what we can say, all these things we can say, now the condition is, if G is greater than R, that means your driving force is much greater than the resistance, then what will happen? As simple as that. What will happen? Definitely it will lead to fracture. Then definitely the crack will propagate, keep on propagating, keep on branching, and your material will fracture. Okay. On the other hand, here I have written wrong, it is less than. Okay. On the other hand, if the resistance force is greater than G, if the resistance of your body, of your material, what you are using is greater than G, then if driving force is less than R, or in other words, if the resistance force is greater than the driving force, then what will happen? So the material won't exhibit fracture, then it will sustain. Your material will sustain, it will not exhibit any kind of fracture. Okay, so now if you want to avoid the fracture, or if you want, in other words, if you want to reduce the crack propagation or crack branching, what is needed according to you? As I told you, two conditions. What are those two conditions? G is the driving force and R is the resisting force. So how to reduce, how to utilize these two kind of forces to reduce the crack growth or to avoid the fracture? Okay, so simple. What are the two ways? So now to avoid the fracture, what we can do? Either we can reduce the G or we can increase the R. That means either we can reduce the value of driving force or we can increase the value of resistance of that material. So if in this two way, if it is possible, we can avoid the fracture and we can control the crack growth. Okay, so now first let us see by G, then we will see by R. Okay, so now G value will reduce by increasing the plasticity, by increasing the plasticity, which will in turn absorb the applied load. What do you mean by plasticity? That means it will not, it will come back to its original position. So what is plasticity? The quality of being easily shaped or molded. Okay, the quality of being easily shaped or molded, that is plasticity. So if we increases that quality, which in turn absorb the, which in turn absorb the applied load, as the strain in plastic region deformation, so the growth of G will be less at a particular loading as compared to non-plastic deformation. Okay, so either if you reduce the G or ultimately if you reduce the force which we are applying on the region, applied load, then the crack growth will reduce or the fracture will be avoided. Okay, now we'll go for the second way. The second way is to increase the resistance of the material, which is very difficult because each and every material is having a fixed resistance. Then how to use this R? So R value of the material remain constant for the given loading condition and temperature. For all the R value for the material remain constant. It will always remain constant for any loading condition and the temperature. But it is a question in front of us to increase R value for the material for the same loading and temperature, but we are having a fixed value of loading and the temperature. Then how to utilize the R to avoid the fracture or to decrease the amount of the crack growth? So for that, what it is needed to do, let us see. To achieve this, we need to study the crack arrest. So this phenomena we need to study. Why we need to study? We need to study this for knowing the value of R. How the R can be increased, resistance can be increased. We will see there are different kind of phenomena through which we can increase the value of R. Okay, so that phenomena is known as crack arrest. So these are the different crack arrest, there are different crack arrest method to reduce the failure rate and to avoid the material replacement as if it is initiated the crack in it. Due to expensive the replacement of material components which the crack initiated can be saved by arresting the crack in different methods. Okay, so that we will see later. First you understand this, like now we want to increase the R. Second part is our to increase the R. To increase the R, the only solution we have is the crack arrest. We have a solution of crack arrest. Now this crack arrest are having different phenomena. So these are the three different type of crack arrest which we can do practically on the material. Okay, so what are the phenomena we have? First one is known as parallel strip method. parallel strip method, or it is also known as crack stiffness. Okay, second one is known as drill a hole method. Okay, or hole as a crack arrester. And the third one is known as self healing method. So these are the three methods through which we can arrest the crack or we can increase the value of R. Okay, so let us see in detail what are these three methods. Okay, let us do with the first one. First one is known as applying crack stiffness patch. This is first one. Okay, strip we are applying. So for that, a simple diagram is there. You can see here. Assuming the crack has initiated, let us assume that the crack has initiated at some point. Okay, or a plate, or suppose here it is initiated. Okay, now crack has already initiated and we started applying the tangential load. Okay, so what will happen if in this plate, you assume you are having a plate. Okay, you are having a plate and here there is a crack initiated. You started applying the tangential load. So obviously the crack will start propagating and the height of this will become something like this. It will keep on increasing something like this and one time this will fracture. Correct? Now I want to avoid this. I don't want it to get propagated from this point to this point. So for that, what I did, I bought a patch. You can see here, this is known as patch. Okay, like how we put in our clothes wherever it is torn out. Same process we are doing for this material. So wherever we have a torn out cloth, we will apply a patch, which resistance must be more than this one. Then only it will sustain. If the resistance of the patch is less than this material, this patch itself will get torn out. Okay, so this patch in the crack tip, near the crack tip, we have to place. Now there, here while placing the patch also, there is one mass behind it. Like simply anywhere you cannot put. The distance between the crack, the distance between your crack tip and the patch where you are applying must be equal to the thickness of this plate. Must be equal to the thickness of this plate. There only you can apply the patch. We will see this. What I am saying is, let us see now. Now due to the loading, the crack will start to propagate as G increases in the material. Correct? Now G started increasing. Okay, now the crack stiffener is inserted in front of crack. Now we have, what we did is we have put one crack stiffener in front of the crack, as it will reduce the kinetic energy of the crack growth. Now what it will happen, it will keep on propagating, but it will suddenly decrease the kinetic energy of that crack growth. And when it touches the strip, it will become zero. Due to this, the G value will reduce and the crack growth will stop. So now suddenly the kinetic energy will start reducing, and as soon as it reaches to the patch, the kinetic energy will become zero. And because of this, the G will reduce and the crack growth will stop. Correct? So, but one thing you have to keep in mind, what is that? The material used for patch should be more value of R as compared to specimen. Just now I told you the resistance power of the patch, what you are putting in the material, must be more than the specimen. That's what I told you. If the resistance is less, means that patch itself will dune. It will tear off. Okay. So now this is the first condition. What is my second condition? The position of the patch in matter is matter a lot in the crack arrest. You cannot simply place it anywhere, wherever you want. It's not possible. You cannot do like that. So where you are placing, it is very important, the place where you are placing. So you can see here, the position of the patch is matter a lot in the crack arrest technique, as we need to place at least one time of its thickness. That means suppose the thickness of this plate, thickness, this is T, thickness of the plate is T. So that much distance must be maintained between the crack tip and the strip which you are placing. Understood? So two things we have to keep in point before placing the strip. First thing is the resistance of the strip or the patch must be greater than the resistance of the specimen. Correct? Second thing, the distance between the tip of the crack and the strip must be at least the thickness of the specimen. Okay, these two things you can consider, and this you can place it here to increase the resistance. Okay, so as the resistance will increase for the system, the G will decrease. Okay, so this is the first point. Let us see for the second one. Easy. Let's go for the second one. Second one is to draw the hole. Hole as a crack arrest. How can a hole can be helped to increase the resistance? Very easy. Take a material with a crack initiated already and loaded, like how we have done seen earlier. Same thing you take it. Due to this, crack will become unstable and material will fail. Now the method of crack arrest called the drill a hole method will come into play. We will see here. Now, drill a hole at the crack tip. So what we are doing, again we are taking the same specimen which we have taken on the last time. This is the same specimen for which we have taken for the strip, placing the strip. So same crack is here, applying the same tensile load. So now instead of keeping the strip here, small strip here, instead of that we are drilling the hole exactly at the tip of the crack. Then what will happen? Why we are doing this? When we have placed the strip, we have seen that the kinetic energy will decrease and it will come to zero and the crack propagation will stop. That's what we have seen. Now when we will drill a hole exactly at the crack tip, what will happen? So now drill a hole at the crack tip so that the back spring effect will increase. What is back spring effect? What is back spring effect? Back spring effect means once the energy which is required to propagate the crack, it will be given back by the hole to the material. Like a spring effect, it will give the same energy will be released to the specimen back, which is required. That means which is equal to G, which will be given back to the material. Okay, so now if you can see here, if you increase the load still here, it will not increase the crack. It will not increase the crack. The crack will not increase. It will be sustained here or it will be located here only. Okay, so we'll see. For example, let us take a structure which have many components which is welded together. So let us take an example or the comparison between the welding and the rivet joints. Okay, for making you understand, we are taking this too. Okay, so when we will take so many structures which are welded together, you assume there are several plates. If this is one plate, on top of it we have welded the second plate lap joint, again we have welded the third plate and all. Now due to the loading, now if I will load this, okay, if I will apply load in this direction and load in this direction. Okay, now due to loading, one component will get crack initiated. Now crack will start initiating here. Okay, and due to this, entire structure will get damaged. So it will get teared out. Crack propagate to the entire structure. But you can use the same component by rivet joints also. So instead of that, if we take and we can join it by the rivets, we can join it by the rivets. Then crack propagate from one rivet hole to the next rivet hole and it will stop after some years of propagation. So instead of making it as a welded joint, if we keep it as a rivet, it will take time. I will show you in the diagram. So you can see here, the next rivet hole is due to the same effect. You can see the diagram here. It will be easy to understand. So what has happened here? What has happened here? Let us see. There is a specimen or the structure something like this, in which we have done the riveted joints here. These are the rivets we have. So in the second, this is known as crack initiation. In the second, crack started propagating. So because of the loading, this crack started propagating. Okay. Since this is not a welding joint, this is a riveting joint. So for the load to propagate from, for the load to propagate from one rivet to another, that means from here to here, it will take years to do that. That's what it is written. You can read this. Crack propagate after long time. So in this, going till here will take year, first year, and going from first rivet to the second year, it will take long time. So ultimately, the resistance power of this system will increase due to the insertion of the circles or the holes which we are doing in that. Okay. Okay. So this you understand it very clearly. Okay. So this is when we make the rivet, the crack will start propagating. It will arrest here for long time. It will not allow here to propagate from next point. It will not start. After long, long, long resistance due to the long time, then only it will start propagating from this point to this point. Okay. So ultimately what happened is the resistance of this system increased. Okay. This process will stop the crack growth, but it can increase the lifespan of the, it cannot stop the propagation of the crack growth, but yeah, it will increase the lifespan of the component. Okay. So this is the second one. The last one is self-healing. So self-healing materials are also known as smart materials, if you remember. Smart materials are the materials which when loading conditions are there, that time the crack will start propagating. As soon as the loading will decrease or the intensity of the load will decrease or it will be stable, it will not gain or it will not increase the length of the crack. It will arrest that crack at its own position. Okay. Once the load is being removed, again it gain back its original position. So those type of materials are known as self-healing material. But this kind of materials are not commonly used. Okay. Why not commonly used? Because it is very expensive materials. These are not the common materials. These are made by composite material, adding so many rainforest and fibers and all, then only it will be made. This is applicable if you have very high pressure or where the expense can be bear off. So like you have aeroplane structures, you have boilers and all, which are very much exposed to the high pressure, high load places. Okay. So let us see self-healing. As like normal human being, we have power to self-healing for the external cut to the skin. Correct? If we have a cut, it can be self-healed. Similarly, for special material, have self-healing characteristic to avoid damage of material, even crack initiated in the material. The material used for special application, like space application, structures need to have this quality. That's what I told you, space applications, aeroplanes and all, it is required qualities, because replacement of this damaged component is very expensive. So once it will get disturbed, once you are unable to get that structure and all, the replacement of those structures are very difficult. Okay, so that's why it is difficult to get those kind of things. Okay, I have one point here. Okay, we'll see later. Okay, so space applications and all we can do, because there we cannot go and replace the material. So instead of that, it is good that we will use the self-healing material there. Okay. Okay, so now we have one more other than this. So these are the three things which we have discussed. One more thing is there. The material shown in the figure is made up of the predefined voids for both resin and hardness. So this is the one other type of help which can increase the resistance of the material. For that, what we did? For that, what we did, I will show you. Okay, this is somewhat, it is very easy to understand. A micro encapsulated healing agent is embedded in a structured composite matrix containing a catalyst capsule of polymerization, the healing agent. Crack form in the matrix whereas damage occurs. So what it is there? Suppose this is your structure or the specimen. Okay. So now this is the micro capsules which we have encapsulated, which we have put in that specimen. Okay. And these are also known as healing agent. And in between there are catalysts we have. So what will happen? Whenever the crack will start growing. So you can see here if the crack start growing. The crack bring into one of the capsule. As soon as it touches the capsule and the catalyst, if both combine together, it will release the healing agent. Okay, the healing agent will release into the crack plane through the capillary action, and it will fill that crack as a self-healing agent. It will fill the crack, contain the catalyst, and trigger the polymerization that bond the crack faces to the used one. Okay. In another diagram, I will show you again. So what will happen? This is your specimen in which there is a crack. In between, there are few resins, or you can say it as a catalyst. This is the hardener. So as soon as you can see in this diagram, the crack started propagating, and it touches any one of the hardener and the resin, combination of both. As soon as this crack propagated and came till here, this will get diffused. This will get diffused, and after the reaction known as polymerization, it will fill this crack. It will fill this crack. It will heal this crack. It will arrest this crack. Fill it, heal it, arrest this crack so that it will not propagate again. So this is also one kind of self-healing phenomena. Okay, that is how it will happen. Okay, so now you can see what is the application where we need this. We need this in deep space exploration, where we cannot go and we cannot replace the material. Instead of that, self-healing material, it must self-heal its system. If you have a structure of a satellite or rocket motor, it's written here, satellite, rocket motor, prosthetic organs, space stations of the present and the future, bridges construction and composite materials, where you cannot go and you cannot replace the system again and again. So for that, what you do in the system itself, you will put some micro capsules, you will put the catalyst, agents, etc. So that once the crack reaches till that point, that will get bursted out, and through the capillary action, it will automatically fill that crack so that the crack will get arrested and it will not propagate further. Okay, but since this is a little expensive, that's why only at the rare places and where the change of the component is difficult, there only we are using it, such as deep space, satellite, rocket motors and all. Understood now? So now, these are the things we are going to do. Fine. Okay. So this is hardener resin and it is going to react it. So due to the crack opening, it will lead to the open, the void, which is predefined and filled with resin and hardener. The resin will mix with the hardener. That means there is some resin is nothing but a catalyst here, and it will mix with an agent, hardener, and it will fill the crack once it is, that means through the capillary action, through the polymerization, it will fill the gap, it will fill the crack, and it reaches its length, which makes it open the resin void. This mixture of resin and hardener will flow into the crack length and it will close the entire crack. This technique can be suggested for the static and microdynamic application. Okay, this is having a limitations with the microdynamic structures. Okay, so today we have seen the crack arrest, and we have seen how the G and R plays the important role. So R are having three different kind of way to increase the resistance of the material. So first one we have seen is through the strip, we can increase the resistance. Second one, through giving the hole exactly at the tip of the crack. And third one, self-healing material, if we are applying. And how we are applying, where we are applying, why for all the materials we are not using the self-healing properties. So these are the three methods through which we can increase the resistance of any material. Okay. Thank you for today.